Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to the Thursday night preaching service. I'm glad to see you all here. And my name is Ted Combs. I know I've met a few of you. There's many of you haven't. My wife Liz and I are from the Outreach Restoration Branch in Independence, Missouri. And we're thrilled to be here. We haven't been to a reunion in many years, and this has been a wonderful experience. So I'm hoping we can come back and do this again next year. I'd like to go ahead and introduce the gentleman up here and all those participating in the service tonight. And we have, to my left, Ron Mann from the Woodbine Congregation. And he'll bring our invocation. And Priest Lane Grosseth, who's from North Platte, will be bringing our spoken word tonight. And Brian Burke from the Council Bluffs Congregation will be bringing our benediction. On piano, we have Dee Ludi. And thank you, Dee, for your piano playing and for the music. And then we also have special music. We have Molly and Allie Burke. So we're looking forward to our service tonight, and I know your prayers will be with Lane and with each one up here. For a call to worship, our theme today, as you probably well know by now, is share your testimony. And the scripture that was referenced for that is Matthew 10:28. So I'd like to go ahead and read that. It's probably already been read once at least today, but that's okay. You can't read the scriptures too often. At least I sure can't. And let's see, Matthew 10:28 says, "Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess before my Father who is in heaven." And to continue in the our thoughts and our opening call to worship thoughts, I was praying about this, and I remembered a scripture that actually I heard used recently, and that comes from 3 Nephi chapter 2. And 3 Nephi 2, in this portion of it with verse 96 through 98, is Mormon inserting, as he does, some of his editorial comments in the record. And I particularly like these because I really appreciate Mormon as the editor and the compiler of most of the what we have as the Book of Mormon. I look forward to meeting him, I can tell you that. And I think it, in that vein, as the compiler and the custodian of the record that we know as the Book of Mormon, I think he is certainly way up there in terms of witnesses of his that shared his testimony and the testimony of all those that he helped preserve through the Lord's blessing. Well, I'll go ahead and read 96 through 98 of 3 Nephi chapter 2. And it says, "And behold, I am called Mormon, being called after the land of Mormon, the land in which Alma did establish the church among his people, yea, the first church which was established among them after their transgression. Behold, I am a disciple of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I have been called of him to declare his word among his people, that they might have everlasting life. And it hath become expedient that I, according to the will of God, that the prayers of those who have gone hence, who are the holy ones, shall be fulfilled according to their faith, shall make a record of these things which have been done." And it's that record that we read from and study and have the fullness of the gospel. To continue in our worship, let's stand and sing hymn 273, let the lower lights be burning, and then we'll remain standing for the invocation by Brother Ron Mann.
Our dear and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come at this time to thank you for all that you have blessed us with, for this beautiful grounds that we meet together on, and for all of the wondrous things that you have invented. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to watch over us, to guide us and to direct us, and help us with those things that we sometimes stumble with. But we know, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will be close to us, especially if we open up our hearts to receive. We pray that you will continue to watch over us. We pray for our brother Wayne tonight, that he might have thy spirit to guide and direct him, that he may feel the things that and the urges of the spirit and bring those things that would be welcome and needed by us all. So watch over us and guide us and direct us, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
For an opening scripture this evening, I'd like you to turn to Doctrine and Covenants 85, starting at paragraph 21. "21B. And I give unto you a commandment, that you shall teach one another the doctrine of the kingdom. Teach ye diligently, and my grace shall attend you, that you may be instructed more perfectly in theory, in principle, in doctrine, in the law of the gospel, in all things that pertain unto the kingdom of God, that is expedient for you to understand, of things both in heaven and in earth, and under the earth, things which have been, things which are, things which must shortly come to pass, things which are at home, things which are abroad, the wars and the perplexities of the nations, and the judgments which are on the land, and a knowledge also of countries and of kingdoms, that ye may be prepared in all things when I send you again, to magnify the calling whereunto I have called you, and the mission with which I have commissioned you. Behold, I sent you out to testify and warn the people, and it becometh every man who hath been warned to warn his neighbor. Therefore they are left without excuse, and their sins are upon their own heads. He that seeketh me early shall find me, and shall not be forsaken.
Thank you.
Thank you, Molinari. Seems like it was only yesterday that I met Brian and Amy, and Allie was just a baby. Time flies. It's very humbling to be with you this evening. You know, Steph and I weren't able to be here last year. And we missed each of you so much. Being here is something we look forward to. It strengthens us. And the love and the friendship and the sense of family that each one of you have always shown us, we're deeply grateful for. I've been blessed this week by all those that have shared testimonies, whether in our services or in conversation. And I hope we never take those testimonies for granted. Even though we don't always remember every testimony that we've heard, I hope in some way they strengthen us and they build upon our own testimony. It's my prayer this night that each and every one of you, from the smallest to the oldest, has a testimony. I pray that you have a testimony of the working of the Holy Spirit in your life, and that you have a testimony of the goodness of God, and a testimony of the surety of the truth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and our Savior. The scriptures tell us in section 76 that those that are in terrestrial glory were those who were not valiant in their testimony of Jesus Christ. Saints, that's calling each and every one of us to be valiant in our testimony of Jesus Christ. It is important and necessary for our eternal lives and celestial glory to be valiant in that testimony. But it is also important for this world and those around us that we're valiant in our testimony. How often, when you've heard someone share their testimony, has it lifted you up? Or maybe reminded you of something in your past that strengthens your testimony? Or maybe helps you remember a testimony that you forgot you had? Every single testimony is important, it's powerful, and it's a gift from God. Which is why we're called to be valiant and share them with the world. To get to the telling of my testimony, at least one of my testimonies, I would like to start with a little history of myself. And this is in no way to boast, but I hope it gives a little bit of background on the importance of testimonies. You know, by the mercy and the goodness of God, my testimony of the truth of Jesus Christ and being a part of his church starts way before I was born. Around the beginnings of the 1900s, my great-grandmother, who my mother lovingly referred to as Grandma Deck, since Deck was her last name, that's all I ever knew her by. Now, Grandma Deck owned a cafe in a small town in Montana where she was raising her family. And right there about the turn of the 1900s, two missionaries of the Reorganized Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints were traveling in that area. And they stopped in the small town and they stopped at my grandmother's cafe. Through the promptings of the Holy Spirit, they proceeded to share that fullness of the gospel with her. In fairly short order, my great-grandmother, through these testimonies, she became convinced of the truth of the gospel and was baptized into Christ Church. And when we speak of testimonies, the story could have stopped right there. I thank the Lord that it did not. Because my great-grandmother, having a number of children, felt compelled to share the wonderful truth of Jesus with each one of them. I don't know exactly how many children she had. I just know it was a large family. And it would be great at this point in the story to tell you that all of her children became strong in the gospel, but unfortunately, not all of them did. However, my grandmother Margaret, who was born sometime after my great-grandmother came into the truth of the gospel, my grandmother Margaret did become strong in the gospel. My grandmother was all of 5 foot nothing, but I wouldn't mess with her. She took going to church. She took the reverence of prayer services. She took the sharing of her testimony seriously. My grandmother, in time, met and married a good first-generation Lutheran, German Lutheran boy named Carl Schiebold. And Grandpa Carl quickly read and believed the truth of the Book of Mormon and was baptized into the church. Soon after that, he became an elder and he served for many, many decades as the pastor of the Fargo, North Dakota branch. Again, very few of my grandmother's siblings were strong in the church, and fewer still raised their children in the gospel. And here again, this could be the end of the story. But because my grandparents had a strong testimony, it is not. My grandparents had a son and 3 daughters, my mother being the youngest of all the children. And I was blessed in my youth with my mom telling me stories of having Elbert A. Smith in their home. And she talks about many nights that my grandfather, who was a night owl, he'd get excited at midnight or 1 o'clock in the morning and think that everybody else should be up too, and he would call people. Finally, until one of his counselors called him at 6 in the morning when my grandfather was sound asleep, because he usually didn't get up past the crack of 9, and he finally got the hint that maybe he shouldn't call people after, say, 9 or 10 o'clock at night. Some of these calls were with Apostle Arthur Oakman, and they debated church matters. Mom and her siblings were raised in the church, and my uncle later became an elder. Between those 4 children, there were 9 of us cousins. eight of whom are still alive. But sadly, out of the eight, only myself and one other of my brothers regularly attend church, and only one or two of those cousins loosely associate with the church. So why am I sharing this? What relevance does it have? I'm sharing this night because for every single one of us, the sharing of the gospel to your friends and family, even to a stranger as you pass through a little town, matters. We're called to study and know the scriptures. We're to know the gospel so that whenever the Spirit moves upon us, we can share the good news of Jesus Christ. Because for someone out there, your testimony matters. I was asked recently if it's really that important to go to church on a regular basis. Going to church regularly and having fellowship with your brothers and sisters matters. It matters because as you fellowship and study together, you have those opportunities to share and to hear testimonies, to strengthen each other, because your testimony matters. At any point over the last 120 years or so, the sharing of the gospel in my family could have stopped. Any one of those generations, they could have grown weak in their testimony. And this gospel and that lineage would have stopped. And I probably wouldn't know any of you. And I probably wouldn't be standing here today if that would have happened. And what is even more sad to me than that is that if it would have stopped, my wife, my four children, and my five grandchildren probably wouldn't have the precious gift of the gospel available to them. Your testimony matters. No matter how big or how small, no matter how insignificant you think your testimony may be, it matters. It's a gift from God. My story in Christ Church started 70 years before I was born. And because of those many generations sharing their testimony, I have many marvelous testimonies of my own. And I know that God works and is alive today. My great-grandmother later moved to Independence and retired there. And she spent many wonderful years attending the Stone Church congregation. She never wavered in her testimony. And because of her willingness to sit down and take time to listen to two missionaries as they traveled across Montana, so far, five future generations have had the opportunity to know this wonderful gospel. So I have to ask myself, what if those two missionaries hadn't stopped in that cafe? Or what if they had, but they had simply gotten something to eat and moved on? What if my mother or my grandmother or my great-grandmother had not shared their testimonies or found it important to raise their families in the church? How many people would have then never heard this glorious gospel of Jesus Christ? I would guess that I am here and many of you are here because someone either shared a testimony with you or with generations and years past. I know many of us have generations of history in the church and our families. But there's also many of us that may be first-generation saints. How beautiful and how wonderful. No matter how you were brought into this wonderful gospel of Jesus Christ, I hope you treasure up that you've had that opportunity. Being valiant in your testimony and being valiant in the testimony of Jesus Christ matters. It's sometimes maybe intimidating to us to share our testimony because it's not something that probably at first anyway comes natural. I don't know this for sure, but I would guess that Brother Francis, when he was young, probably took more than 2 or 3 minutes before he got into asking people how their life with Christ was. But as he did it over and over again, it became part of his being. And it was sincere. It was because he cared about the person. We have to see people as God sees them. Individuals made in his image, handcrafted by our Heavenly Father, each and every one. And he loves them just as he loves us. And we have to see people that way. Your testimony, no matter how big or how small, matters. Your caring enough to share your testimony with someone can truly bring them new life. And it can bring them a hope that they didn't have before. As we look about this world, what is missing in so many lives? It's hope. There's so much despair, and despair turns to anger and hatred. And we see that all around us because there is no hope. This gospel of Jesus Christ is a gospel of hope and of new life. It takes away the hate and the despair. It brings people together as creatures of Jesus Christ. It brings us together as his family. People need that hope. When I was in college, I took a lot of time studying the scriptures, studying what other churches believe, even attending some other churches. So I wanted to know for a surety that this gospel of Jesus Christ, this fullness found in our Holy Scriptures, was Christ's true church. And I'll tell you, brothers and sisters, there is no other church on the earth today that fulfills what the Scriptures say it should fulfill. This is the church of Jesus Christ. When we become the body of Christ together. And for the young people that maybe haven't had the opportunity yet to fully read your Book of Mormon, I want you to know that that book is true and it is the Word of God. And we are blessed without beyond measure because we have that fullness of the gospel, those things that are made pure and precious and plain for understanding. The Book of Mormon is a gift, and if you have a testimony of that gift, share that gift. We have heard testimonies. And we have seen miracles on these very grounds. Miracles more than once. I hope that we don't take them for granted, and I hope that we appreciate them. But I also hope that we grow our faith so that miracles become something that's so commonplace to us that we would almost take them for granted because we know that God moves and acts upon our faith. We've heard miracles of maybe an example of God's perfect timing of sending the rain that saved a crop from dying. Some of us have had miracles where a stranger has maybe handed us $5 in our time of despair. Some, as Jared shared this morning, is when the Lord, through all odds, works to bring a new job. Or maybe it's his perfect timing that we were at that intersection a second before or a second after an accident took place. It's not just a coincidence when those things happen. It's a hand of God moving in your life. And I hope you don't underestimate those testimonies and the power of those testimonies. Testimonies can be big and they can be small. And I had numerous times in my life when I was young that I knew God was working. But I want to share tonight a testimony, and this is probably especially for the young people. And it's such a blessing that we have so many young people with us. But I want to share a testimony that this is probably the first time that I realized with a surety that God loved me and he cared about me on an individual basis. Some of you have heard this testimony before, but I want to, again, especially share this testimony for the youth, because I stand before you this night to proclaim that I am convinced that the Creator of the universe knows your name and he cares deeply about you. So I was probably about 16 years old when this took place. I grew up in the country on gravel roads, and we lived about 2.5 miles down to windy gravel road. And in fact, south of the Platte River in west central Nebraska, we have our own version of the Lois Hills. They're very similar to where we're at right here, and they're just as beautiful. Anyway, we lived on this gravel road, and even before I was legally supposed to be driving, I did a lot of driving. And I had a habit of driving way too fast. And it's either way too fast for the road conditions or probably way, way too fast for my driving abilities. The running joke in school was that I spent more time in the ditch than I spent on the road. And I can tell you, every walk to a neighbor's house to make that call home to dad to come pull me out of another ditch was not a lot of fun, but it didn't seem to slow me down. But I want to tell you about this particular instance, and on this day, I was not driving too fast. It was in the spring. I bet most of you know, when the spring showers come, what the dirt roads around here turn into. They become pretty muddy and pretty slick. At this time, our road was very, very muddy. In fact, the ruts in the road left by people going before was probably 2 or 3 inches deep in mud. And because of this mud, even if I would have had wanted to go fast, it was impossible to go more than about 10 or 15 miles an hour. I was probably going a lot slower than that at this time. The mud was taking my car all over the road. I was trying to be extremely careful. At one point, I was going up a small hill, and I became stuck in that mud. And this hill had just enough of an incline, and the mud was just thick enough that even though my car was stuck and the wheels weren't turning, the mud was pulling me off the road towards the ditch. My first thought was, I don't want to end up in the ditch again because my dad's going to kill me. But my next thought was to pray. There was truly nothing else at this moment I could do. So right there with my car being slowly pulled towards the ditch, I closed my eyes and I said a simple prayer that God would help me. I had no idea what kind of help I wanted or what help I needed. And I didn't put any stipulations on God for what the help should be. Oftentimes, don't we have a tendency to do that? We not only tell God we need help, but we tell him how to do it. I didn't put any stipulations on God. I just was desperate and needed help. And I tell you this day that when I opened my eyes from that simple prayer, my car was no longer sliding towards that ditch. In fact, my car was now sitting on top of that hill, dead center in the middle of it, and I was completely out of the mud. Now, this was not a life or death situation, and it probably wasn't as dire as my 16-year-old mind thought it was at the time. But in that instant and in that quick prayer, our Heavenly Father, the creator of everything we see around us, heard my prayer and he answered it. Now, if God hadn't answered that prayer, the worst thing that probably would have happened to me that day was a ruined pair of shoes and a car stuck in the mud. I tell you none of this to boast, but I tell you this in praise and thanksgiving of my Heavenly Father, that God still works today. He is alive. He cares about every single one of you, and he does hear your prayers. Brothers and sisters, God hears your prayers. He may not always answer them how we like or how we try to direct him to answer them, but he acts on them in his wisdom and for his purposes. I have testimonies of healings of my youngest daughter and one of my granddaughters. I have testimonies of God's perfect timing, of him working in my life when I thought there was no hope as far as the situation I was in. And just like Mark shared last night, I too have a testimony of the time when the tornado skipped over this campground. My son was here and God heard the prayers of a father 300 miles away. And he heard the prayers of many that night. I remember that night, sitting in my office at work, getting phone calls from my wife, and then looking at the radar, not knowing for sure what was going on, because we were back in North Platte at the time, but praying right there at work over and over again, and knowing now that the prayers of many were lifted up. God answered prayers. God has moved in my life so many times, so some small and some great. And I pray that there's other times when I have the opportunity to share those testimonies with you. Our testimonies are important. Your testimonies are important. They're important in your church. They're important in your families. They may be what a stranger needs to hear. Let the Spirit prompt you and go with what the Spirit has for you to do. Our testimonies are important, and so are our prayers. And God commands that we go to Him in earnest prayer. I'd like to share with you from Alma, the fourth chapter, starting at verse 5. Now I would that you should understand that the word of God was liberal unto all, that no one was deprived of the privilege of assembling themselves together to hear the word of God. Nevertheless, the children of God were commanded that they should gather themselves together oft and join in fasting and mighty prayer on behalf of the welfare of the souls of those who knew not God. We heard this last night, the same thing, and we heard this throughout the week. The Lord is pleased when we come together to lift up our prayers, to lift up our prayers for each other, to lift up those prayers for strangers we may not know, and to lift up our prayers for the welfare of those souls who know not God. This world is full of those who know not God. And it is my prayer that we more earnestly make that part of our prayers always for those who know not God. We should pray for the welfare of the souls of our family, our friends, and strangers. We should lift up mighty prayers for the redemption of Zion. And we should cry with earnest prayers for our brothers and our sisters who have turned away from God. I ask you this night that you add those names to your prayers. We all have people we know that fit these categories. We all have loved ones that we wish would just listen to the gospel. It may take years, brothers and sisters, but pray for those people. Pray for their souls. The Lord has mercy, and He cares about them very greatly. The least we can do is pray for them. The week goes by so fast. Monday night seems like it was just yesterday. And now we're almost at the end of our time together. But we're blessed because we still have a couple more opportunities to come together as the children of God to lift up our prayers together mightily to Him. Let us cry out to the Lord together. Share your prayers and share your testimonies. Your testimony may strengthen the faith of one who's wavering. Your testimony may be the vessel that finally reaches that heart that has been so cold towards the gospel. Your testimony may bring someone you love into this church of Jesus Christ and into everlasting glory. Your testimony is important. All of us this day, no matter the age, all of us are called to do this work of the Lord that's laid out before us. Each of us has been given unique talents that when they're put together, can and will bring about His wonderful kingdom on earth. If you're not sure what your calling is or what work the Lord has for you to do at this time, make it a matter of patient prayer. Not just once in a while, but always. And make it a matter of much study. And make it a matter of sincere fasting. Pray that the Lord will bring His people together of one heart and of one mind for His glory and for His glory alone, so that His purposes may be fulfilled. Brothers and sisters, I know your hearts, like mine, long for Zion. We've been given a taste when we gather together, when we come to places like this, when we hear testimonies of those who have seen Zion, and we long for it. We long for it, but the world needs Zion. Society as we know it is crumbling. Morals are disappearing. The only redemption that can ever come to this earth is through the kingdom of God and a people totally living according to His will and His commandments. Are we ready to be that people? Are we ready to fall on our knees in mighty prayer, to come before Him with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, to turn away from sin, and to be that people He's calling us to be? I'd like to turn to Matthew, the 13th chapter. I'd like to go to verse 39. 13. Chapter 13, starting at verse 39. The harvest is the end of the world, or the destruction of the wicked. The reapers are the angels, or the messengers sent of heaven. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of the world, or the destruction of the wicked. For in that day before the Son of Man shall come, He shall send forth His angels and messengers of heaven, and they shall gather out of His kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and shall cast them out among the wicked. Brothers and sisters, let us not be found in that lot. And there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth, for the world shall be burned with fire. Then shall the righteous shine forth as a sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a treasure hid in a field. And when a man hath found a treasure which is hid, he secureth it, and straightway for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field. Would we sell all that we have for this glorious gospel of Jesus Christ? It is our treasure. It is more precious than all the gold in the world. And again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchantman seeking goodly pearls, who, when he hath found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind, which, when it was full, they drew it to the shore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but cast the bad away. So shall it be at the end of the world. And the world is the children of the wicked. Zion must needs be so this corrupt world can end. Brothers and sisters, we probably can't fully comprehend the beauty and the perfectness of Zion. This Babylonian system that we know of money and of greed and of trade and corruption must be ended for God's perfect way to shine through. For us to live according to God's commandments and not the ways of the world, we have to serve one another unselfishly. The scriptures tell us that we're only in the service of God when we're in the service of our brothers and sisters. Let us serve each other with a willing heart. Let us serve our Heavenly Father without waver and with joy on our hearts. This work of Zion needs to be so that the testimony of a better way of living, a better way of treating each other, and a better way of serving our Heavenly Father shines through to this world. Let it shine so brightly that the world cannot ignore it. They may then run from it, but let them not be able to ignore it. For when that city on a hill shines forth, those throughout the earth have been searching for something better. Those that have strived to live as best as they could towards what they know will flock to that glorious city of God. Some of them have to have it in front of them. They have to see it before they know what they're looking for. The Church of Jesus Christ, His church, must take up the mantle. We must stop acting more like the world and instead be Christ's church on the earth. We should never run before the Lord, but He has called each and every one of us through His scriptures to take His word into the world. Your world might be the backyard across the fence at your neighbor's. Or God may be calling you halfway across the world. Wherever He's asking you to go, be prepared to share your testimony, because your testimony matters. In the fifth chapter of Matthew, Jesus tells us not to hide our light under a bushel, but let us shine through the world, to the world. Brothers and sisters, let your testimony, let your light shine. Last night, Brother Mark told us his dream and how the church was dwindling smaller and smaller. Until that point when they finally fell on their knees and prayed with an obedience and a mighty prayer to God. And they were humbled and then endowed to take forth the message to the four corners of the earth. Off and on over the last 15 or so years, my family and I have been coming here to Reunion. Sadly, our numbers have gotten smaller over time. Is this the year we say enough? Is this the day we go before the Lord and say, we are humbled, we are ready to fall on our knees, we are ready to turn to you, Lord, in mighty prayer, to use us to go out into the world so that your gospel will be heard throughout the nations? You Your testimony matters. Last night after the service, Bo came up to me and he said, "Lane, do you need anything for your sermon tomorrow night?" And I said, "I don't know, Bo. What do you got for me?" He told me a hymn was kept coming to him. That hymn is 166, if you'd like to turn to that in your hymnals. Awake, ye saints. You know, Bo, I did need this hymn. Awake, ye saints of God, awake. Call on the Lord in mighty prayer, that he will Zion's bondage break and bring to naught the fowler's snare. He will regard his people's cry, the widow's tear, the orphan's moan, the blood of those that slaughtered lie, pleads not in vain before his throne. Then let your souls be stayed on God. A glorious scene is drawing nigh. Though tempests gather like a flood, the storm, though fierce, will soon pass by. Awake to union and be one, or saith the Lord, you are not mine. Yea, like the Father and the Son, let all the saints in union join. Let us, saints, be one under the head of our Heavenly Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. So in closing this night, value your testimonies. Value the testimonies of each other. No matter how big or how small your testimonies are, they are important. Value them and write them down. Replay them often in your mind. And remember them, but don't keep them under a bushel. Be valiant in your testimonies and share them often. Share them again and again, even if the people you're sharing them with have already heard them. They lift each other up. They lift me up. And for those of you that are sitting out there that maybe don't think you have a testimony or are not sure if it really is a testimony, make it a matter of earnest prayer. Look for those times when God has moved in your life. Sometimes maybe your testimony, he had to move in a way that wasn't real pleasant for you, but he was trying to steer you back to that narrow path and that rod of iron. So many of us need to hear that testimony. Ask God to show you through the nudgings of His Spirit of those times when He was working your life so that you can realize what your testimony is. Your testimony is important. You are important in the eyes of God. And your simple testimony could lead to generations of souls coming into the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Being together with each and every one of you is something that I treasure. Being on these grounds is a blessing. I thank each and every one of you for your service to our Lord, for your prayers, when we're here and when we're apart, and for those testimonies that you've shared this year and over the years. You have blessed my life and you continue to bless my life. And it's my humble prayer this night that God would bless you and keep you, until every time we can meet again. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Lane, for your admonition, that admonition that each of our testimonies of the love of Jesus Christ is important. Let's remember that and learn from it. Let's sing from the hymnal 274, Shout the Tidings of Salvation, and then we'll remain standing for the benediction by Brother Brian Burke.
God, the Eternal Father, as we close this evening service, we pray, Father, that you would bless each and every one. I ask a blessing upon each and every one, that you would place a hedge round about them in their lives, and that they would be protected from the things of the world that would easily beset them and try to draw them away from you. I pray, Father, that you would guide and direct each and every one for the paths that they will walk in the days to come, that you would protect them and that their paths would be on solid ground, that they might not stumble and fall. And if they do, Father, may you catch them. I pray that you would help us to put on that whole armor. And we are children and need help being dressed, Father. Be our armor bearer. Teach us how to fight those battles, and we know that you will fight our battles for us. But you know that we must struggle, and we must strive to do those things according to thy will. Help us in this. We trust you and believe in the words that speak that the righteous will be gathered May we be that people that are gathered. May you break the bonds of Zion so that these things that we participate in at these reunions might become a daily walk. That they might be something that we would look forward to be our everyday lives, to be gathered with people of one heart and one mind. That each one would strive to do their best, to do their duty to you, our God, our Savior, and our King. Forgive us those things that we fall short in. Help us not to be caught in the fowler's snare. Help our eyes to be opened, looking towards that light, your light, that we might not wander in darkness, Father. And we praise you. We pray a blessing upon us this evening. And ask these things most humbly through your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.